Thanks, Miriam. I'm happy to be. I've been to Gloucester one other time, a long time ago. Remember that movie, The Perfect Storm,
yeah.
Came out? And my partner Diana lives in, was from Concord and Lincoln. And so, we got to go to Gloucester and see where this storm was. And so, came up here during whatever, one summer and had a beer at the Crow's Nest. And I've been since advised not to eat anything at the Crow's Nest. or drink any of the water there. So, but anyway, last night was the biggest storm I'd ever biggest rainstorm I'd ever been in, and apparently it was nothing. That was a.
$60.
Then this morning I went up to this breakfast place, and there's huge waves, bigger waves I'd ever seen, and apparently they normally slosh over the streets, but anyway, that's my Gloucester experience. And this is a Jewish temple, and I was thinking I should have worn my yarmulke. And have you ever been to a reverse bar mitzvah? So the regular bar mitzvah is what, 13?
Yeah.
Okay, so I happened to stumble. I was in this hotel and stumbled upon this guy who was having a reverse bar mitzvah, and it was when he was 31, and. Everybody was dancing, and men only. I guess there were some women there, but it was wild and crazy. And I got to dance with the honored guest, and I should start bringing my bar mitzvah just for, I guess, good luck or something. I don't know. But anyway, I'm here to talk about cohousing and particularly aging. And issues around aging and how we're going to take care of ourselves when we get our age, I guess, by now. Time flies, right? And we were talking at the dinner. We went to have dinner last night, and I thought, I should play this one clip about retiring communities and whatnot. So I'll play this. I don't know if you like this kind of stuff, but.
Hey, buddy. When'd you get in?
What are you doing here?
I told you I was retiring. I moved in next door.
Mr. Kornstein died, and it's a beautiful apartment.
Yeah, your folks said it was for rent, so I jumped on it.
Kramer, you can't live down here. This is where people come to die. Not you. Older people.
Don't eat cookies for breakfast. I'll fix you something. How about a feta cheese omelet?
That sounds great, Mom.
If you feed him, he'll never leave.
I don't have any feta. How about cottage cheese and egg beaters?
I guess.
I don't believe this.
I know. Don't I look more relaxed?
I don't want to end up being the young guy at the retirement community. So, but Kramer, I think, is in a lot of our similar boats in terms of needing some place to go and needing some people to kind of watch after him. Even though we feel like maybe we need to foist ourselves on our relatives or our friends or whatever. But how can we do this without having to pull a Kramer and drop in on Del Boca Vista Phase 2 onto our friends. Getting ready for this conference, I'm going to tomorrow in this talk, I put a Facebook post up about just to find out, what people thought. And who will be your caregiver when you're elderly? And amazingly, there's 2,000 people read the thing, and how many people responded? 658 people responded to this post, and so which I was amazed, and some of the people who had been on the list for quite some time, said, what's up with this topic, right? And so here are just some of, I don't know if you can read those, but here are some of the responses that were given.
If we could read them, we wouldn't be here.
Yeah, exactly. Here, I am on my own. I take responsibility for myself. I have no idea. My child, all were quite young when I am old, and I don't want to be saddled by such a burden. I have no idea. No one. So this is people are thinking about this, and these are people who are on the cohousing listserv, so chances are they're maybe interested in this at some level. But it's a quandary people have, and I don't know whether or not you all are like that or in that boat, but it's something that's on everybody's minds. This is a little bit about myself. But what we're going to do today is talk a little bit about cohousing. It's cohousing 101, and a little bit about caregiving in cohousing, largely based on my experience. I was nearly died in 2013, and that was happened to be, and I was living in cohousing, and talk a little bit about my experience there. And then integrating the cohousing approach into other senior living arrangements, kind of I call it the secret sauce, the cohousing secret sauce. So one of the things that's characteristic of cohousing is this sort of idea of consensus and everyone kind of making decisions based on what everyone else thinks. And so one thing that is a characteristic is really kind of setting cultural norms for wherever your community is. And we have our own little community here, and just these are fairly typical. You probably had these in other meetings that you've been, but the norms and expectations. Listen, be respectful, talk one at a time. Some people are going to talk more than others. Share the floor. And what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. So we might be talking about stuff that maybe you don't want to have out there in general public. And so the idea is just to kind of keep all that kind of stuff within the bounds of our little community here. So I always ask.
Challenge by choice.
That is, some people participate a lot. You remember in high school, there was always that kid in the front that always had the answer for everything, or the kid that always had his picture on every page of the yearbook. Those people. Not everybody is going to be participatory, and so it's okay to not say anything, or maybe you want to have a conversation in a small group or whatever. And so it's this idea of dealing with other people's personalities and how they interact with others, because you end up with all sorts of folks. So that's challenge by choice. So we'll do a little introduction exercise. This is the other thing that you will find is characteristic of cohousing, is getting to know people in ways that you normally don't get to know people. In cohousing, it's this idea of getting to know people at a deeper level, like almost right off the bat. And so what we'll do today is kind of go through kind of a simple exercise that is kind of typical of cohousing. And these are icebreakers that you can use not just for cohousing, but your church groups or your school groups or your community groups, whatever. Rather than what are you going to do this weekend, which is kind of dull, or what book are you reading, can talk about something a little more personable. So since we have so many people, maybe we can turn to somebody who you don't know and introduce yourself and say your name, and just for fun, your maternal grandmother's maiden name, and talk a little bit about who's going to take care of you when you need to have someone talk to you, to care after you. Let's take a couple minutes to introduce ourselves. Here, you can team up with me.
All right, that's great.
So, what's your...
I'm Deborah.
Deborah?
My maternal grandmother's name was Bertha Cohen. Or Kahn, not sure. And I imagine, hopefully, John and I will take care of each other.
Take care of each other?
Hopefully.
All right.
I'm John.
John?
And my maternal grandmother's name is Alfonsina Moschella.
And you're going to take care of her.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, I'm Alan, and my grandmother's maiden name is Iwasaki. And theoretically, I have people to take care of me. But I'm always kind of like getting my circle of people, just in case. You never know what's going to happen to people. Yep.
Yep.
All right.
Don't want to be in a nursing home.
Right.
We're regular. Have to plan it. Super rich, so here we are.
Got to plan. Got to do a little planning, pre-planning.
Yep.
All right. But anyway, this is just kind of a taste of kind of how the groups fall together. You'll get a group of people, like a burning soul of some sort, and they'll gather up their friends and family and relatives and neighbors, and you want to get to know people. And this is the type of thing where you can do it like pretty quick. And something that's safe. And you can pick any question. Grandmother is what I use, but could be what's your third grade teacher, your favorite relative, your favorite pet. So anyway, this is just a taste of.
Or questions when we have to sign in for a security question.
That's it, exactly. Here's just kind of a brief overview about cohousing. It kind of got started in the United States in the 70s. There are two people, husband and wife, Chuck Dredd and Katie McCammett, and they've written a couple books about this. And they made up. There's some term. There's a term. There's all European languages have these terms for something that would be equivalent to cohousing. I had taught a class in Amherst here 2-3 weeks ago, and there's a woman from Belgium, and she said, "Well, this is what we would call it." It was some Flemish word of some sort. But anyway, there's some long Danish word for cohousing that doesn't have a definition in English, and so they came up with cohousing. So it's kind of a made-up word, and I wonder if it's in the dictionary. It should be. Generally speaking, cohousing is just a group of people, like such as yourselves, who decide that they want to come together and own a place in a community, in a neighborhood, and share in the maintenance and upkeep and the ownership of those common spaces. And so have you ever lived in like a regular condo complex or an apartment house or a dormitory? In dormitories, you know, everybody has their room, and they're down in the basement or somewhere. There's like a place where there's pool tables and the TV set and maybe a kitchen. So that's kind of the setup, is that it's like being in the dorms. In fact, I call living at our place the dorms.
So you might not all be in the same building, though, right?
No, you don't, may not be in the same building. In our case, we have one building, and we have two separate outbuildings that are duplexes. And in some places, I went to Saugerties in New York. They have these little cottages that are like, I think they're duplexes, but they're just separate buildings. And so there's all kinds of configurations, and we'll talk a little bit about the configurations for cohousing. And so the data are: the typical cohouser is liberal, high social class, high levels of education. Caucasian, and 70% of the time a woman. And so, I don't know, for whatever reason, more women are attracted to cohousing. Maybe, I don't know why that is, but could be. So, yeah, exactly. You don't want to hang around with men. Maybe more social. Yeah. There's more women than men. Yes. How come women always survive their husbands? I want to know what that's about. And the other typical thing about cohousing is private residential ownership. And so, but over time, this is kind of changing to be all kinds of different configurations. But the typical cohousing, like where I live, everyone owns their place, and we share in the ownership of the common space, which would be typical of a regular HOA that would be a condo association. And this is the other thing that I think is different. It's possibly organized around a higher purpose. And we'll talk a little bit about higher purpose in a little bit here. So this is what people think of cohousing, what cohousing is like. There's a movie that they made about cohousing.
You ready for your meeting?
Yep.
Knock him dead, all right? I'll call you later.
You know what I want to do? I want to take off that robe and...
Why are you not at work, George?
I forgot fired.
As soon as we can get back on our feet, we'll come back to New York. But right now, my brother's offering me a job, and Atlanta's the best place for us to be.
Ah! Hey, there he is, my homeless brother. Where's your cardboard box? And Linda, oh my God.
Ah, your body is redonkulous.
Rick, I think you're making everybody uncomfortable.
Oh, everybody knows what I mean.
Here you go, simple data entry. You want me to enter this data? Are you questioning me? Don't question me.
Are you serious?
Am I serious? You're fired. You're rehired. Consider that a warning shot.
Let's get the hell out of here.
All right, I cannot be in this car anymore.
Elysium Bed and Breakfast.
You're looking for the B&B? There's another half mile. You can't miss it.
Leave?
Yeah.
Oh, no, no.
Oh, my God, he's coming out. He wants to make a suit out of our skin.
You guys okay?
We'll take care of you. My name's Wayne, by the way. I'm a nudist.
Oh, yes, we noticed your penis earlier.
Touché!
All these people live here. This is a commune.
We prefer an intentional community.
We're not a bunch of hippies sitting around playing guitar.
Woo! Wrap your fingers around the base of it, work the shaft down to the tip, and then flick the tip.
What?
Flick the tip, flick the tip.
Welcome to the Elysium community!
It's not like we're signing a lease. We'll give it a month.
2 weeks.
Oh, George, I like you.
I like you too, Eva.
We should make love sometime. How'd you and Linda feel about that?
This place is incredible.
I actually feel like I'm a part of something that's real.
What is this?
Ayahuasca tea.
Reeks like a cat butt.
It has hallucinogenic properties.
I can fly!
You can't fly!
I believe I can fly!
If you're gonna get literal with an R. Kelly song, do Trapped in the Closet!
Wanderlust.
So, I'm light on your bio. You know, man, is it cool if maybe we talk about this later?
Take your time.
That last scene you think is funny, but it's you get to know people to a greater extent than you would your normal neighbor. That's one of the other characteristics of cohousing. And you know, I think people think of cohousing as this commune or you know, hippies and Easy Rider and Peter Fonda and all that stuff. And so when you go to elected officials or banks, you know, they think, what's co-housing? Is that some hippie thing, or who's going to pay? Who do they have jobs? You know, the sort of weird stereotypes that come about as a result of people trying to develop co-housing. And so, I think over time, co-housing has sort of gotten legs of its own, and people are more aware of what it is. It's called Wanderlust. Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty funny to watch. But you know, you get good trailers, and you know, who needs to watch the movie, right? You know exactly what happened. We were talking to breakfast about someone. I was talking to somebody about one of the biggest, I think, challenge of cohousing is really kind of putting a square peg in a round hole or a round peg in a square hole. It doesn't fit in. It's like totally opposite of American dream. That's sort of the reverse of the American dream. And people working together supposedly to a greater extent, and it's more communal and whatnot. This is a picture below of some people who are net weavers, and that's always kind of an allegory. The Polynesian Islands, groups of people tie knots and make nets, and the nets are supposed to, you know, sift and sort and catch and release. And a source of strength for the community. And so that's kind of what cohousing is about, is net weaving, and as opposed to Michael Douglas.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated. In the last seven deals that I've been involved with, there were 2.5 million stockholders who have made a pre-tax profit of $12 billion. Thank you. I am not a destroyer of companies. I am a liberator of them. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
Great.
I think intellectually we say, well, Gecko's approach is a little bit extreme, and do we really think like that? And so one of the challenges that we're faced with cohousing is, okay, regardless of whether or not what we think about Gecko and Wall Street, somewhere in our heads we have issues about that, about climbing our way to the top and being number one, and rugged individualism, and being the best is better. And so in cohousing, it's just the opposite. Smaller is better. Clawing your way to the bottom and working with other people. And that to me is the biggest challenge, because you're still in a private property situation. You're still trying to maintain the value of your property, because most all your money, if not a good portion of your money, is tied up in your house. And so you want to be sure that you maintain that. And so the trick is coming to an understanding of what are you willing to give up of yourself and of your property value and of your net worth in order to benefit everybody. And it's sort of how the tax bill was made. You know, you have some people that have bigger houses and more value in their houses. And question is, what are your neighbors willing to give up of that in order to help out maybe people who have smaller houses or the affordable houses? And that to me is really the crux of cohousing either makes itself or breaks itself. And so my thought always is that if you're going to have a cohousing community, they should all be kind of the same size house. They should be all the same, kind of the similar economic status, so that, for instance, if in our place, we have houses that are $1 million down to houses that are $200,000. And that's only because we live in a high-value area, a lot like this place. And in order to do a development, you know, you're only allowed to have X amount of houses on a piece of ground. And so you have to figure out how you're going to make expenses, and the developer, in some cases also the community, how do you make money? And that's to me the paradox of cohousing, is balancing the American dream with the cohousing dream. What's this about? Private ownership. How does this work? It, you know, typically, and if you read, I think Miriam had Chuck Durrett's book there, but typically how it works is you get a bunch of people together, and a few of you will emerge as leaders and the burning souls, and try to get everybody organized. Ultimately, cohousing is this sort of a development scheme for developers to self-fund their projects. So for instance, you would want to be in it, and you get to live in a house. So, okay, you sell your house, and then you basically put it into this project. You own a house, you sell it, and you put it into the project. And so you're able to, over time, you know, generate, you know, several hundred thousand dollars with a collective people of 30 households, chipping in, say, $100,000, and your house may be worth, the house you sell may be worth more than that, obviously. And so you're able to kind of self-fund the project. Ideally, if everybody's house sold at the same time, now that's a perfect model. But people have other things going on. They're not really ready to sell yet, or their house has been on the market for 2 years and it hasn't sold yet. So what are some, these are the kind of the constraints of cohousing. They take, it's not a quick process. Under the typical model, it takes 2 years just to get through the process, at least in my town. I don't know what it's like around here. And then another couple of years at a minimum to get sticks in the ground. So you're talking 4, 5, 6, 7 years of development time before you actually get into a house. And I think that's typical of pretty much any development. But what if we were trying to figure out a way to build them and they would come, as opposed to think about it and think about it some more and think about it some more and then maybe get around to building it. So let's see, what else do we have here? Also, the idea of the culture being defined by the owners, who would be the community members. The idea is to have shared tasks, and we have, you know, 5 or 6 little groups of people who help us clean the common house or trim the trees or whatever the various activities happen to be. And as I mentioned, you know, it's not really a very sustainable approach, particularly if you're, you know, wanting to get into something right now, quickly. So you would try to find a place that was already existing, and there is an opening, a place for sale. And in Massachusetts, there's co-housing all over the place. And, you know, if you needed to find a place, or if you wanted to move into an existing community, there's ample inventory out there to look. This is Germantown Commons in Nashville. And this is Suzanne, God rest her soul. She was one of the original founders and just passed away here recently. And they were, you know, put blocks down on a piece of paper kind of to figure out the configurations. And there's, I think, Chuck Durrett back here, actually. That's Chuck Durrett helping supervise the activity. It's a self-governing HOA. I think you probably have HOAs in Massachusetts. Homeowners associations, for maybe not. Yes. And typically, the state government highly regulates HOAs because there's, you know, construction defects and all kinds of negligence that HOAs perpetrate upon the owners of the of their units, of the members of their condo communities. And the departure by co-housing is we use this consensus approach. Everybody has to come to agreement, basically, whenever decisions are made. And you'd be surprised at the kinds of decisions we have to make. Do we have the potluck on Wednesday, or do we have it on Thursday? Or do we lock up twice a week, or do we get to lock up 3 times a week? Stuff, a lot of decisions. But 95% of it is pretty routine. But it's that 5% that sometimes causes a bit of consternation. Sure. Yeah. Well, I would say that the cleanest way is to bring in some outside guy like me. And so, like, for instance, you know, Joe over here is this a guy who's going to be a little bit problematic, and you know Joe, but I don't. So I can make those discussions happen and get people to kind of talk about maybe some difficult issues that they wouldn't normally talk about. And because the idea is that typically what happens is that you have some people, you know, I'm talking about the kid who's on every page of the yearbook, you know, and they're always wanting to be involved with everything. They always want to have their finger in every decision, and they want to be the leader on deciding what the whatever it is. Well, you have to, it's a matter of flagging that right at the very beginning, so that that doesn't happen. Because what happens is that person ends up still being the kid who has their picture on every page of the yearbook when your community is built, and it's hard to unwind that. In fact, at Germantown Commons, they had that situation. They didn't flag it soon enough, and they had a special retreat. They brought in someone from North Carolina to try to nullify that dynamic. And you know, you don't want to hurt feelings, and you don't want to burn people out. And at the same time, you don't want to scare people away either from doing the jobs. So right at the beginning, if you can kind of figure out, okay, how can we manage this as a team? It's really what it is use everyone's abilities and assets to the greatest extent possible, but understand that it's 10 people working together, not one person telling 9 other people what to do. This is how we have it broken down. We have a common house team that deals with the common house. We have a gardening team that works in the yard. We have a buildings team that changes the light bulbs and that sort of stuff. Legal and finance team. These are where, you know, if there's a place for the kind of the control people and the point A to point B left brainers, this is a good place for those folks. And then for the opposite, the right-brained, empathetic types, the community well-being team. And so the problem we run into is we have a lot of people that just stay on the same groups, and they get it stagnates out. So we've been trying to have term limits for people, so that people can become more cross-trained on all this sort of stuff. In fact, our gardening team got disbanded because of a personality problem, and that person, one of those people, a couple of those people have changed out, moving around, but still, it's a little in a bit of disarray. Well, you know, we're going through this right now. Our place has been going for 10 years, 11 years, going on 11 years. When it first started, everyone who's 50 is now 60, and everyone who's now 60 is 70, and so forth. And when we have this sort of traditional management approach, and it's becoming pretty obvious that that's not working or it needs to be changed. So we're trying to figure out, because what happened is that participation now is largely sitting in meetings and talking about stuff and saying, okay, who are we going to hire to do this other work? And so we're trying now to figure out, okay, how can we balance that out so people are trying to contribute a little bit, whatever it is. Maybe it's just putting the plastic newspaper bags into the dog poop thing on the sidewalk and that sort of stuff. But you know, there's some people who are really into the liturgy of cohousing. You got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do this, you got to do this. And other people participate, but they don't participate in a liturgical way. And so, the work always gets done, regardless. And so, it's a matter of unpacking the liturgy and deciding what jobs there are, as opposed to mandating you have to do X, Y, or Z. So yeah, that's an issue, and as our community ages, it's going to be changing, constantly changing. Yeah. Right, we job out, unlike most co-housing communities, we job out the snow removal, the heavy yard work, which is mowing, and cleaning the common house. And you would think someone would want to be okay with cleaning the common house. But, you know, what we figured out is people have, you know, other people, cleaning ladies and cleaning men who come into their places to clean their houses. So if they're not going to clean their own house, what makes me think that they're going to come in and clean, you know, the common house? So we figured out that, okay, we'll just hire that job out as well.
So is there some kind of way that you can balance people that are able to do more work versus people that do not do or do not want to do more work and prefer to hire out? Can you, some kind of a, I don't know what the word is, but what?
Yeah, it's called. Yeah, it's called pay to play.
Okay.
And the co-housing community across the street, Wild Sage, they're going through this discussion right now about trying to quantify how much what everyone does and how much maybe it would be worth. So that's something that happens, although it's, you know, not desirable, because you got to, you know, try to figure out, you know, the trade value, or is it actual money value, or what have you.
Do you have a equivalent of a condo fee per month to cover the common expenses such as mowing the grass
right.
and stuff like that?
Yeah, we do, and it's based on a combination of a number of people who live in your place and square footage, size of your place. So there's some combination of that on stuff like trash removal. If you have more people in your house, then you pay more for trash removal. Or if you have a bigger place, obviously you pay more for maintenance based on that. So
what's the average fee?
It varies. They vary from $200 to up to, we have some big units, up to like $600. It's quite a range. The other issue is someone who was asking about what's the ideal number. Maybe you were asking that before. And we have 16, and that's just not enough, because what happens is, to spread the same value over 16 units versus 30 units, for example, you know, the ones across the street, that's they're 30, and their HOA dues are much, much more reasonable. So it's just dependent on the on the numbers.
Is there a number that
seems
to be too many?
I think like, when you get into the 40s and more, I think that's too many. And you hear of them that are 64, 65 units, and I think, you know, they seem to function, but I think they're maybe too big. Because it's just because of the, you can hide too much, which is, I guess, a good and bad thing.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
What's been your experience around age discrepancies, or the variance of age?
Well, you know, it's kind of both. It goes kind of goes both ways. Like, you have young families, and they have jobs and kids and all that stuff to handle. And then you have people who don't have the abilities on both extremes. And so it's, and I think that's why the one across the street, it's a multi-generational place. And I think people, they're like, for instance, the younger families, maybe they'd be more willing to pay, so they don't have to take time out from their jobs or take time out from their, you know, their family lives. And people who are not able are able to pay in a little bit more, or maybe everyone helps buy those down if people are having really difficult times. So I think it's all over the place, and it's just whatever matches up with whatever the community happens to, you know, find works out for best for them. The shared community spaces, these are typical in our place. We have 16 units, and so like this courtyard is owned undivided equal shares among 16 units. So everyone pays 1/16 of the maintenance costs for keeping up the yard. And that holds true for the common house as well. We pay 16%. So in addition, so that's all equally distributed. And then the other, some of the other stuff is divided by per capita and by square footage.
Additional housing for guests
Yes, we have one guest room, and which is pretty typical. And people, I think we charge $25. And some sort of cleaning fee, kind of an Airbnb approach. That's in the basement of our common house, and it's a small place, and there's not a private bathroom. The room that should be the guest room, plumbed out for it and everything, that's now it's rented out to an artist, and I guess they figured out that the artist pays more than had we tricked it out and brought in, made it into a guest room.
Is there a reserve fund that would cover expenses that are common to everybody? That's the first half of it. But the second half, take insurance. I assume there's something that everybody has to have minimum insurance, so that if something hits, you know, it might hit two units, and those people all of a sudden can't say, well, I don't have any money to cover this, and I'm not going to fix it.
Yeah, we have a reserve fund, and I don't know if the state law mandates what the percentage is, but we maintain the reserve fund to a pretty high level, which, you know, I don't have a problem with. Some of the other folks think that it's overfunded, but so yes, we have that. And then in addition, our insurance company required that each of the homeowners have not in addition to their own property insurance, like special assessment insurance for in case there is the roof blows off or a tornado hits or whatever. So yeah, we have, I call it global warming insurance for these kind of weird disasters that we didn't used to have or think even have to think about, hail, whatever it is. Let's see what else. We have dinners. That's one of the community things that we have in our common house. And we have, unlike a lot of communities where they will split up the cooking duties or this group of people will cook for this week or whatever, we have potlucks instead of prepared meals. So in a sense, we have even jobbed out our community meals. We just bring food and we don't have to cook with other people. And incidentally, I think the cooking with other people thing is something that really is something that's good, but at the same time it's bad because you have some people who are really good cooks and people want to always go eat their food, but then you have someone like me and no one wants to eat hot dogs and Van Camp's beans all of it for their common meals. Or every twice a week we have one Wednesday and Sunday. So what's today? Sunday. I'm missing out on our community dinner tonight. Let's see. Higher purpose. Now, so higher purpose, it sounds like some kind of religious thing, but it could be something not about that. It could be everybody is senior, or it could be everybody's a vegan, or everybody is an accountant. My across the street neighbor says, what kind of community would it be of all accountants? But beans. But the higher purpose of having accountants would be that what they would do is all get together and do taxes for the homeless shelter, which happens to be up the way, or give tax advice to the senior center or at the senior center every year. So there would be a higher value or higher purpose to a community of all accountants. And in our case, we don't have any higher purpose. Our higher purpose, and I think it's problematic, is basically maintain the community so that we don't lose money on our resales. And so my thought is there really needs to be something that's other than that. So when you're squabbling over reserve dues and all that stuff, what is there that you can do that's not about that, right?
And
well, yeah. Well, that's coming up.
Oh, okay.
and also this higher purpose has something to do with that as well. And so I wanted to talk a little bit about around spirituality. There happens to be one going in Boston that's called the Urban Moshav in Boston.
And by the way, I have flyers on that. So,
right. It's this guy named Randy Studley, and he's got one going in Berkeley. And the idea of the Moshav, I think Moshavs are kind of new. You all may know more about this than me, but it seems like there's more agricultural based, there's more private property based, and so it fits in a little bit with cohousing. And it's going to be their higher purpose is going to be around some sort of Judaism, and I think whatever it's like. Reformed Judaism, is there something like that? But everyone would be doing all the co-housing duties. So if you're interested in that, so they're looking for people. All right, so on to the caregiving part. After you decide whether or not co-housing might be something that you're interested in pursuing, there's this whole idea of loneliness and longevity. And I made this movie about that, and I participated in a study that my neighbor told me about, where They're trying to measure whether or not social activity, mental acuity, physical activity increased your potential for longevity. This is the second movie in the Aging Gratefully series about how intentional community members can be helpful to each other as we get older. Our story today is about exercising, brain health, and neighborhood relationships. The focus of this project is Germantown Commons in Nashville, Tennessee. Meeting with friends, gathering with family on holidays, relaxing at neighborhood or workplace parties are activities for exchange of thoughts, team building, and emotional support. Do interpersonal relationships translate into better health as we age?
In fact, I'm working on this project that's about whether or not health and exercise, which was the basis of the study, has any bearing on whether people live in an intentional community like cohousing.
Intentional communities are the perfect laboratories to learn whether living and recreating together result in longer, happier lives. Coincidentally, one of my neighbors circulated a flyer about a study at the University of Colorado, which is intended to measure just that. Curious to find out about how physical health relates to forming positive relationships, I signed up.
Gentlemen, we can rebuild him. We have the technology. We have the capability to make the world's first bionic man.
Professor Angela Bryan is the University of Colorado principal investigator behind the Aging, Exercise, Brain Health, and Positive Relationships study.
Right now, the demographics of the United States are such that we're an aging population, right? And in some ways, that's great because we're living longer than ever before. But the challenge in adding all those extra years to life is to make them quality years, right? So how can we keep people functioning independently, being able to do all the things they enjoy, and having a high quality of life as they get into older and older ages? So we were really interested in seeing if we could use physical activity as maybe a tool to help older adults increase their quality of life. And since we're neuroscientists, we're interested in how the brain might mediate those effects. All that sort of combines to the FORCE study, where we look at older adults who aren't optimally active, who could be more active.
I took some physical tests to determine my initial stamina level, some mental quizzes to check my memory.
NLSB.
Yes.
And an MRI to establish my baseline brain functions. Thank you.
was deemed a fit research subject and walked on a treadmill for 30 minutes at 2.5 miles per hour, three times a week, 48 times over 16 weeks. Afterwards, I was retested to see if I had made any improvements.
What we're very interested in is what are the impacts of exercise on the brain, and how do those translate to the things that we know are important for quality of life, like being independent and having a good social life and things like that.
Meeting with friends, gathering with family on holidays, relaxing at neighborhood or workplace parties are activities for exchange of thoughts, team building, and emotional support. Do interpersonal relationships translate into better health as we age?
In fact, I'm working on this project that's about whether or not health and exercise, which was the basis of the study, has any bearing on whether people live in an intentional community like cohousing.
Intentional communities are the perfect laboratories to learn whether living and recreating together result in longer, happier lives.
I was talking to a girlfriend on the phone a little while ago. She said that I seemed happier. She said, you've managed this. You've had your moments of being anxious, but then you come back. And she said, you just seem to be doing really well. So it shows even to people that have known me for 30, 35 years, you know? And I feel more hopeful too. I feel hopeful about my retirement, my future, my next years, you know?
One of our community members passed away. Sophia, we all loved her so much, and it was really hard. And it was an eye-opener, now that you mention it, of the fact that here's these people that we, and have a new connection with. And you know, that's one example, but there's been other examples of the messiness of life that just happens as you go through life, and you have this whole new connection of people where those messes are happening and you're participating in it.
The happiness quotient is much higher now. And, I thought that occasionally I would say, I shouldn't have moved here. But I have never said that. And occasionally I need to take a break. I go on retreat and get someplace where I have to be alone. But then I always look forward to coming back.
For a lot of people, being active isn't necessarily all that rewarding, right? So they do it, they know it's healthy, but it's not fun. And so doing physical activity with people, making an appointment to, you know, go for a walk with people, making an appointment to meet a friend for a hike, doing physical activity in a social setting can make it a lot more rewarding than slogging through it on your own.
My happiness quotient is much higher now. And, I thought that occasionally I would say, I shouldn't have moved here. But I have never said that. And occasionally I need to take a break. I go on retreat and get someplace where I have to be alone. But then I always look forward to coming back.
Even if you don't choose intentional community living, get off the couch, meet people in your neighborhood, join a club and volunteer, attend family gatherings whether you get along with your relatives or not, or any other spontaneous group activity. Your life may depend on it.
The basic idea is that living in community and doing stuff with people is something that will help improve our health. And I was surprised that my acuity improved after just this being in the study as short a time as it was. Because it measured stuff like, okay, did I go into community dinners and going to meetings and things that I didn't particularly think was a very good idea or I didn't enjoy that much. But turns out they have a positive benefit to me because I was doing it with other people. So you don't really have to be in cohousing to follow through with this. Like if you're in a book club or if you have a meeting at this temple or whatever. So rather than just sitting here, get up, walk over to the coffee shop and have your meeting there. If you're having a book club, walk over to the library and have your meeting there. So what does that do? It's not really adding on anything else. Like, for instance, I was what she was talking about. I'm not the person who goes out and jogs 5 miles a day. I'm a unintentional, inactive person, right? But the walking that I do just in the course of life, rather than maybe taking the car, I'll walk that extra 2 blocks and take somebody with me.
How long did the study cover?
It covered me for 6 weeks. I had to do this for 6 weeks. And I was amazed because all I did was walk on this treadmill for hardly at all. But I had to, have meetings with people and whatnot. So this is why cohousing, I think, is kind of a hedge against loneliness, because the idea is that you're with people all the time, and it'll get you used to being with other people. Like, for instance, my partner's mother ended up having to go back to Colorado and live in assisted living. So, which was good, and she lived in this one called Minuteman Independent Living, and it's in Concord. And she got to know her neighbors and that sort of stuff, and then she went from independent living to assisted living in Colorado. And I remember this happened on several occasions. There were these people who would be brought in kicking and screaming because they're lost, because their kids made them sell their house, move out of the house for whatever reason, and move into this assisted living place. So what if they were in tune to living in a group, in co-housing ahead of time, and they're used to living with people as being kind of the course of things, as opposed to losing their independence? And so what if they understood that they had their independence all the time when living in a community-based approach like co-housing? So it would be more of an easy transition to when you needed more care. And in fact, if we have 4 people moving out of our community within the next 6 months, and they're kind of aged themselves out of co-housing. They're getting to be close to 80. But they're all moving in together into this continuing care residential community. And so this is how co-housing can be a good kind of bridge to getting people aware of living together, helping each other, getting to know each other, and then not having these societal pressures about losing your independence.
I'm just wondering, does co-housing ever become another Rotary stage of life?
Yep, that'll be the upcoming slide. We'll be talking a little bit about that, and because it really needs to evolve. So what about the 89% or 90% of people who are in the middle, regular people? What can we do to make a CCRC and assisted living and nursing homes affordable to people who are in between? And so that's where I think co-housing can kind of come into play. Because
I think this is the
challenge. Is how do we use co-housing as an approach to creating, I guess, an environment for people who want other people around, they want other people to help out, and they can't afford to move into a CCRC, for example.
Are people still having their own private finances, or have you created a social community?
I think those are some questions that need to be asked. But the idea would be, people would still live in their living in their own homes, kind of like the Beacon Hill Village approach that they have in Boston, where you don't have to move anywhere. You just kind of live where you're at, and then you have a support network. My next door neighbor, he kind of used the Beacon. His wife is now living in a nursing home for Alzheimer's, and she lived in community for all this time, and just over the last couple of years, she's had to move into a long-term care, nursing care, but she's in hospice and is in relatively speaking, you know, she's doing just great. And, you know, it's this idea of regardless of I guess, your perceived cognitive abilities, she's able to, she's, you know, recognizes people around and all that sort of stuff. That's an example of how outside resources could be brought in and provide a degree of assistance without any additional cost, really, and before she had to move into a hospice situation. So the idea of living with people in this community, in addition to just having a place to live, people helping, providing the support.
So what were people doing to help this particular resident?
Like when Henry had to go do an errand or go to the store or whatever, there would be someone who would come in. Or to drive her to her daycare programs, just various things. And also supporting the caregiver, which would be, okay, Henry has to go to this caregiving meeting, like, but he needs to go to the someone needs to go to the grocery store, so and that sort of stuff. My experience. Well, I was, you know, I didn't know anything about cohousing. Well, I'll play this little clip, and that'll kind of tell a little bit about it. Over the past few years, I found myself in all sorts of life transitions I didn't expect. Like everyone, I've been a member of many communities in my life. I never imagined I'd ever join a yoga studio. I had a lifestyle change and had to regain my strength and flexibility while recovering from a death-defying illness. There's been quite a bit of talk lately about alternatives to nursing homes, retirement communities, and assisted living facilities. Do we age better together? And is there power in community? Another mystery for me was why I moved blindly into the Silver Sage Village co-housing community in North Boulder, Colorado. I had no idea 5 years ago that living in an intentional neighborhood would play such a huge role in saving my life. Cohousing is a neighborhood of people with private lives, private homes, but choose to live together as a community. Neighbors also share in the ownership and upkeep of spaces such as the garden and common house. I wondered what some of my neighbors thought about growing old among their peers. All of us are over 50 years of age. What are their perspectives about aging in community? Margaret Porter retired from the federal government and moved along with her husband Dan to Boulder from Maryland. Margaret's husband Dan Nifong is a retired college professor. He and Margaret are among the original Silver Sage members. Henry Kroll is a retired public television staff member. He and his wife Jean moved to Boulder from San Francisco. John Heiler is a mostly retired facilitator and mediator. He and his wife Deanne are longtime Boulder residents. Lindy Cook is a retired nurse who recently moved to Boulder from Kentucky. She is among the newcomers to Silver Sage Village. Jim Leach is president of Wonderland Hills Development, which developed Silver Sage Village. He and his wife Brownie also live in Silver Sage.
Silver Sage really came out of the work that Chuck Durrett did when he went to Denmark and studied what the Danes were doing with the cohousing model. You know, cohousing originated in Denmark.
There was one cohousing community, a senior cohousing community in Denmark that really impressed me. Started by five couples in their early 50s, and very much out of denial that it was easy for them to imagine a happy and successful elderhood.
I also wanted to find out if there is any research happening about cohousing.
The work that I've done with cohousing has led me to believe that there's something very positive happening there. It's not an easy way to live because you are living close to other people in community and people kind of know your business.
You know, I had this glimpse into the future about, what I might be like when, I was unable to walk and when I was on supplemental oxygen and I was unable to, wipe my butt.
I am in the presence of the spirit of Christmas yet to come.
Fortunately for myself, I recovered.
They may have been in a college dormitory or they may have been in the army, but where do people live together in any way in America? Hardly any place.
What advice do we have for anyone interested in joining or developing a cohousing community?
Number one is you've got to be real about it's housing you're doing.
Have really thoughtful conversations about how you're going to be compassionate with and care for one another.
One of the things I'm also very interested in is this idea of mutual support and how can older people help each other.
The pathways would all conjoin, so anybody leaving the unit, if Jeannie was to wander, she'd be observed by one of the other neighbors. People would also congregate outside when the weather's nice and Jeannie could join a conversation so she could engage with people.
We've always assumed that everybody is going to have family who will take care of them when they get older. And that really is not the case for everybody. For one reason or another, they don't have family or they're far away or whatever.
All of a sudden, when I came home after 6 weeks and flat on my back and in rehab, people started bringing over food and people started providing that kind of neighborly caregiving stuff. It was just good to know that there are people around.
Friends like that, then you like that. It's downhill. There's going to be a time when I am unable to contribute.
It's going to take a lot longer than you thought, and it's going to be much more difficult, but much more of an opportunity for growth for everyone involved than you might possibly imagine.
I'm first and foremost, what's the most critical, and the mantra in our office is, if it doesn't work socially, why bother?
Living in co-housing isn't easy. Facing up to personal changes and meeting those challenges continue to be important as we age. As for myself, over the past couple of years while regaining my health, I've thought a lot about my life and my life priorities, and I'm opting for more privacy, at least for now. Regardless, I'm confident there will always be caring people around to provide neighborly support for others.
So that's my story. I didn't know anything about cohousing and didn't really, I kind of intellectually kind of knew what it was, but I didn't really get it until I got sick. It was something that really made me realize, well, like I say, got visited by the ghost of Christmas is yet to come, and it wasn't pretty. And so it's a matter of, at least for myself, realizing, how important it is to give care to other people. Like, my neighbor needs to go to the hospital, I go. And so it's not even a matter of, well, I think about doing it, or maybe you can get someone else. That's just my call to action because of, how people took care of me. So I think that's, the issue about caregiving is that you have to be into it. It's not like I'm going to wait for Miriam to call me if they need help. I'm going to say, well, what do you need, right? I'm going to volunteer that up. And so it's this idea of becoming intentional about living in with your neighbors. So that's why we say about the pay it forward. Aging out of cohousing. Yeah, there I showed that slide about there are more adult diapers sold now than baby diapers sold now for adults, right? So there's something to this aging thing. And so anyway, we were talking about what are some things that can happen. Like I say, cohousing is a good way for people to kind of get used to this idea of living with other people and not being so foreign that you're asking for help from others or giving help to others. It just sort of sets the table a little bit and kind of gets you into that mindset of you don't have to do this all by yourself. This is kind of our Silver Sage Village annex, is that Manicare? And that's where I was, and it was a mile away. So people go there, and it's easy to drop in on folks, even drop in on people you don't know. I even go do that these days. Pecan Hill Village has been going for, I don't know, decades in Boston. And this is just neighbors who organize themselves to take care of one another. And this is the whole idea about cohousing, is that's the cohousing secret sauce without having to necessarily build new houses. You can find a bunch of your neighbors or get familiar with your neighbors and maybe set up a Beacon Hill setup. They have it's pretty sophisticated now. They have softwares and meeting platforms and requests for information platforms. So I think the Beacon Hill Village approach is something that's co-housing light, because you don't have to necessarily build anything new, but enter it into, just apply it to existing construction. There's one in Washington State that's called SHAG, Sustainable Housing for Ageless Communities, Ageless Generations. And what that is, they build rental apartments and rental condos, whatever, and really kind of apply a quasi co-housing approach. It's still kind of a top-down thing as opposed to, resident-centered. And so that kind of a idea has some potential. That was new construction. And then, of course, continuing care retirement communities. There are some that provide care for or provide decreased monthly rents and buy-ins for people on Medicaid, I believe, but very few. Their market is different. Their market is to market to people with high net worth and high pensions and whatnot. So this is kind of narrowly focused, but very, very successful. So I think really, how do we make continuing care retirement communities for everybody else? How does that work? One of the things we've talked about at our place is, because we have this guest room, and we have another room that's rented out to an artist, what if we were to turn that into an actual apartment and have someone on hand, maybe a CNA or a groundskeeper, someone who can provide kind of day-to-day stuff. We talked about, what if we turn this run room that we have for exercising into a place where you could do medical care but we found the licensing requirements for something like that it just doesn't make any sense. But if that were built from the ground up, what if you built a community that had this in-house care living quarters and in-house care facility for just checkups and various things like that? Would that be possible? In Colorado, we looked into assisted living, and we found out that you don't have to go through licensing or permitting procedures if it's something that you just have happen. Like my neighbor Henry, he would bring in people to help give assistance. And if we didn't charge any money extra for that, but if we started charging people to use these in-house people and CNAs and whatnot, then we would fall under the licensing requirements of the state of Colorado. Right. But then the whole other thing would be, okay, that person would still be able to go work someplace else. Like they would have a day job, but they would be maybe trading out for free rent or cheap rent be by being available to the residents. It would be for nursing as well as could be for just general maintenance.
So the economics of it would change depending on how many people needed care at any given time, and whether you offer full-time employment to
one person. Yeah, right. Would be like on call. For 16 people, it may not be workable, but if you had, like for instance, at Cambridge Cohousing, they have a place where people, where a person stays, or a number of, two or three disabled people, and they provide, and their Medicaid or their insurance provides funding for that caretaker to work with those residents at Cambridge Cohousing.
So then Cambridge Cohousing has some affordable domicile versus being all
right.
People that have wealth.
Right.
Right.
Cornerstone had, in fact, most of them in Massachusetts, they seem to have affordable. And so, if you want to get in touch, there's my contact information. If you have other questions or. No, General Do-Gooder, yes. So we have time for questions. I do know that it happened pretty quickly, and they had really good support from their local government to make that happen. Make it happen, and it's kind of a high-rise type thing. It's condos, but it's not it's vertical and not so horizontal.
But then there's still community spaces and.
Yeah.
Experiences with cohousing. Interesting. One was in Ithaca, New York, a place called Longhouse. I think there were two buildings, common area, potlucks, and so on. it was 40 years ago, and the people who were in it were the age I was then, which was in the 30s, and they had potlucks and so on. I never really visited that, but recently, and this is co-housing, but I was in Silver Spring, Maryland, where my sister-in-law lives. They have 300 units. They have an interior courtyard and balcony, so everybody can talk to each other across the
right.
balcony. I stayed for 2 days in their guest room, which is on the same floor. They have five stories, these things. And you know, they support each other. I mean, my sister-in-law is 74, her partner is 90. She's still doing sort of okay, but is close to maybe getting a little demented. It's a very different sort of, 16 or 30 is like, this is huge, and yet it's co-housing, and they do all this stuff, you know, they do all that hassling and looking out for their neighbor and stuff, so it's a very interesting experience. This is just 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, in Jamaica Plains, they have a co-housing there, and they're kind of set up in this horseshoe shape, and it's very intentional about being able to see what other people are doing. And you know, I might also add is that, you know, the whole idea of caregiving, it makes it sound like that, you know, you're always taking care of somebody or whatever it is, or tending to somebody. But the whole idea of co-housing is that it happens all the time. And there isn't any, it's kind of seamless. It's not an add-on. Caregiving is not an add-on. It's something that just happens. And just through the interaction that you have with your neighbors and where you go pound on your neighbor's door for a cup of flour or I need an egg or you got a stick of celery, that's caregiving. And the whole idea is that kind of activity and that sort of interactive activity is what helps you become healthier and what helps you live longer is working with others.
For the decision making, if you want to move to a place, just like co-ops, I believe, not condos, then you have a board that decides if you're the right fit. Do they have that?
Well, Yeah, the whole idea is the first group of people are the only ones who can really self-select yourselves. And then after that, when like, for instance, I were to want to sell my house, I can sell it to whoever I want, but I can't discriminate against who I sell it to. Or what we can do is we give them this, that everybody has to take a clinic, a co-housing clinic. Just this is what we do, this is what's expected. You have to be on a team, you have to lock up, you have to whatever it is the community requires of people who live there. And so then people can decide, okay, well, do I want to do that or not? And so the idea is that people just don't move in and not be co-housers. People generally who have at least some interest are the ones who, I guess, get picked. But then I ultimately decide, I ultimately decide.
Not rules, but this is
right, right. So you decide to sell your house, you sell whoever you want, but they have to go through this process.
As my wife mentioned, we visited a lot of classes, places. Like just a couple of weeks ago, we stayed in one out in Pioneer Valley. And it's really different in different places. We have visited some co-housing where they had new families moving to bedroom, I knew they were moving. It went through a realtor, and the realtor didn't stay in there. There are others where, like the one we were at in Pioneer Valley, if your place is going on the market, it first has to be offered to the whole community. And somewhere there is a board that has got to, that decides that you have to spend a certain amount of hours and attend a certain number of meetings. And so it was weird. There's no part of it.
Well, there's
a monthly fee. And it's
listed right on the listing sheet, just
why
like
the real estate person would bring that to the attention.
It was listed as a homeowner's listing.
Yeah, see, in our case, we have more of a prescribed process, so that sort of thing doesn't happen. Well, I would say that as opposed to a formed community going under, I don't know if that ever happens, but I would say that it's more likely that a community doesn't come together for a variety of reasons, like land isn't available or land's too expensive or something that doesn't really have to do with the community itself. You might have a group of people who are together. Here are some of these that are trying to get organized. And they've been in organization phase for, you know, 5, 6, 7 years and, having potlucks and meetings and all that sort of stuff and not really getting off the ground. But as far as a totally dysfunctional community, I don't think that, you know, once you get to a established state that is, I've never heard of anyone like the co-housing thing going away and they just turned into regular condos.
Can you back up a little bit, because you both mentioned something that's happened in Malden. It kind of piqued my interest when they mentioned that the city actually got involved to an extent. Do you have a sense of where and how and what compelled the city and what that was all about?
I think it's just like affordable housing for all places. I think they ended up having, I think it was like a cash, there's a chunk of money that they had to buy down units, like a grant somehow, and I'm not sure if that came directly from the city or wherever it came from, but the idea was to have buy down the prices of market rate units. Maybe they're smaller market rate units.
So for example, the town had some kind of fund that subsidized.
Right, and I think they left that up to the community to figure out how to do that. And I'm not sure if it was a direct grant from the city or if it was some kind of over issue of financing that they set aside for that, but.
Can you talk about models that you've seen that have been retrofit rather than built from the ground up?
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe, where have you stayed? There's one going on in Cincinnati, I think. They came out, they were in Boulder for some reason, and I think it's almost like a co-housing within existing HOA. Like, for instance, it's a tall high-rise, and then maybe 20 of them are going to be have the secret sauce, co-housing secret sauce poured on them. And there's one in Boulder called Boulder Creek, and that's a huge, 400, 300, it was a huge HOA. But there are two or three people who had bought up maybe half a dozen of them, maybe more, and they rent them out. And so it's a co-housing within a existing HOA. And that's something that happens
on a rental basis.
And so like the common house is one unit that also happens to have the guest rooms. And then there's other co-housing. The good thing about that is that you don't have to worry about, okay, who's going to paint the house, what color you're going to paint the house, who's going to fix the roof. You don't have those kinds of reserve discussions. And so the community just has to figure out, okay, when are we going to have the next community service project? And this is one where they worked with the master HOA. They funded seeds and gardening stuff. And then the co-housing community, as their community service, went and redid the master garden or the master park or did something. So that was how they fit into the bigger HOA. So yeah, that happens.
I'm just curious, how many of
Well, I think the number is like around 150 that are occupied, and then there's a whole bunch of them that are, or 150 that are in various stages, but mostly occupied, and then there's a whole bunch of forming communities.
There's one forming in Belmont. When I was looking for Alan, as it turned out, I talked to one of the people from Belmont, and that was last spring, and they were looking for land, but they had determined that they were going to have to go farther out into exurbia to be able to afford a large enough piece of land. So they were going to be semi-rural, I believe.
Yeah, in fact, I saw, where was that place we drove by? It was like the Fairview Inn or the Fair Play Inn or something. The Fairview. There was. I saw a building that looked like a boarding house or something that was for sale there. That would be.
Oh, you saw the old TCB house. You saw the TCB house, I think.
No. You saw the Fairview Inn, which is on the way to Niles Beach.
But the actual Fairview Inn is set way back.
Well, whatever we saw was on the front, was close to the road.
Yeah, and there's. There's a property, and yeah, it was for sale. And so that would be a good retrofit project, because it looked to me like it was a, I don't know what it was, a hotel, is it a motel? Yeah. Yeah, because it looked like it was set back. There was some white building. It was like a drive-in, and yeah, so that would be a pretty good little place for a co-housing in Gloucester.
All Gloucester's old hotels burned.
Yeah. Homeowners Association. Oh. Hi, you're welcome. It's always a pleasure.
So again, these are the flyers on the Boston Moshav. If anyone's interested, I think I've got about 20 of them here. You can pass them around, take one if you're interested. And again, this is the book by Charles Durrett that I've been using, the Senior Co-Housing Handbook. And it's really very readable and interesting. It's
lots
not
of pictures.
Dry at all. It's not dry at all, and there's lots of pictures.
And here's a Silver Sage
He's
Village.
The architect.
There's Silver
yeah.
Sage Village yep. on the front.
Yep. And there's a tremendous amount of discussion about, you know, the architectural priorities and so on. The benefits of working with a developer who knows how to work with cities to get the proper permitting and all of that. So it's very worth a read. I'll send out a follow-up email on this. I have anybody that registered through the temple, I have a list with all of your emails and whatnot. Anybody who didn't, if you just want to come to me for a minute and if you'd like to, you know, get a follow-up email, I will do that. You know, I'm hoping that there's enough interest that we might, you know, get together again and see if this thing might have legs on Cape Ann.
Thanks, Marianne.
Thank you.
Yeah, it sounds like you could do some real work, Marianne.